joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of glory. Our hearts are yielded now before you, open to the Son. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of life. Our hearts are yielding now before you, responding to the Son of God. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of life. Our hearts are yielding. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Our hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Our hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son. Fully joyful, we adore you. Joyfully joyful, sing your praise. Joyfully joyful, we adore you. Joyfully joyful, sing your praise. Joyfully joyful, we adore you. Joyfully joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory.
Joyful, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful.
Our hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son above. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son above. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son above. Oh, joyfully, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyful, joyful. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyful, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyful, joyful, we sing your praise. Glory, Lord of love, our hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son above. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love, our hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son above. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Our hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son above. Joyfully, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyful, joyful, we sing your praise. Oh, joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyfully, joyful, we sing your praise. Are yielded now before you, responding to the Son above. Oh, joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Our hearts are yielded now before you, responding to the Son of God. In joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let
of his love and wonders of his love.
Yes, he rules the world with truth and grace and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love. And wonders of his love, and wonders of his love. And oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ. For he alone is worthy, for he alone is worthy, Christ the Lord. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come let us adore him. All the glory, but we give you all the glory. We give you all the glory, Christ the Lord. Forever we will worship, forever we will worship, forever we will worship Christ the Forever we will worship. Forever we will worship. Forever we will worship. Christ.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ki se prana mosatana la la mo. To switch the keys. She cambra mosatana la la mo. Ki prene na masplara. Father, we worship you. We thank you for your only begotten Son, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Merry Christmas, everybody. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this wonderful time to be able to worship you with a special interest, worldwide interest, in the moment that you gave your only begotten Son. Father, we thank you for Bethlehem. We thank you for the manger. We thank you, Father, that you are willing to do what you did, that you are willing to give us the means by which we would find redemption, the means by which our sins would be washed away, a means by which we would enter into the realms of your glory, leaving all the shame and all the darkness behind. Father, we praise you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Just lift your hands towards heaven.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father.
Lord, we worship you. Father, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. I hear three people. Lord, we worship you. Father, we thank you that you move us beyond the complexities of songs and chords and keys and instruments and microphones and sound systems and into a place of worship, God, Almighty God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kurama mandom brada kiste de lindo robo tombande le de kiste predesi asto tolo robrata. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the wonderful ministry of the Holy Ghost and power, for your baptism and ministry upon our lives today. Lord, we ask you right now that every eye would be open, every ear be open, every heart be open. Lord, that every single person in this place would understand, Lord, what you came to give to us 2,000 years ago, what you died so that we may have and receive. Lord, what you raised up from the dead so that you and I could walk in all those wonderful realms of glory. Father, may every eye see, every ear hear, every heart understand. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mandara sete rebekiste. Hallelujah. 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 You can be seated. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord, is the mighty God. He's the master of everything, and his name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. Oh, he's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is he. Oh, we bow down before him. We love and adore you. Oh, your name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Lord, your name is wonderful. Oh, your name is wonderful. Your name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. You are the mighty God. You are the Almighty God, Master of everything, Master of everything. Your name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. You're the great shepherd. You're the great shepherd. The rock of all ages, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Lord, I bow down before you. Lord, I bow down before you. I love and adore you. I love and adore you. Your name. Your name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Oh, your name is wonderful, Lord, your name is wonderful. Your name is wonderful, Jesus, Jesus, my Lord. You are the mighty God. You are the mighty God, Master of everything, Master of everything. Your name is wonderful. Your name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. You're the great shepherd. Oh, you're the great shepherd. The rock of all ages. The rock of all ages. Almighty God. Almighty God is He. Lord, we bow down before you. Lord, we bow down before you. Oh, we love and adore you. Lord, your name. Lord, your name is wonderful. Jesus, my Oh, you're the great shepherd, the rock of all ages, Almighty God is He. Lord, I bow down before you. I love and adore you. Oh, your name is wonderful, Jesus, my Emmanuel, Emmanuel, our God is here, and He's Emmanuel, Emmanuel, hallelujah. Emmanuel, our God is here, and He's Emmanuel. Oh, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, His name is God. Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Emmanuel, he dwells in me. Oh, the Lord dwells in me. His name is called Emmanuel. Emmanuel. Oh, Emmanuel. Your name is called Emmanuel. You dwell with us, Lord. You dwell with us, and your name is called Emmanuel. God in our midst, God in our midst, God in our midst, and your name is God, Emmanuel. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. And we worship you. And we worship you. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. And we worship you. You became the Son that we might be made sons. You became the Son, the only begotten One. You became the Son that we might be made sons. You became the Son, Emmanuel. You became the Son, the only begotten One, the only begotten One. You became the Son that we might be made sons, that we might be made sons. You became the Son, the only begotten, the only begotten One. You became the Son, Emmanuel. You became the Son, the only begotten One, the only begotten One. You became the Son. You became the Son that we might be made sons, that we might be made sons. You became the Son. Oh, Emmanuel, you became the Son that we might be made sons, that we might be made sons. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bako sara ate share namlaye. Ushare bamba revele mano. Let me lead you in my liturgy. Kuzambra rave shata kina lo bilaha. This is why Christ Jesus came, so that the Holy Ghost might live and dwell in you and me, so that his glory may be revealed through us, that all the world might see the heavenly. This is my liturgy. Christ, God Almighty, living in me, manifested by the Spirit, the Holy Ghost and power, in tongues and interpretation and tongues, in prayer and praise, singing and making melody. This is my liturgy. Christ Jesus now in me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can sing joy to the world all you want, and if the joy hasn't hit you yet, it's really just in vain, because Father has sent forth his word, and he's directed it right at you and me, and the word that goes forth out of his mouth and the word that has gone forth out of his mouth shall not return unto him again void, but shall accomplish those things which he's purposed. But he's not going to force it. He won't force you. And if you allow his word to come into your life and begin to produce the fruit that he ordained, then you'll go out with joy. Ha! You'll be led forth in peace. And the mountain and the hills will break forth into singing. And all the trees of the forest will begin to clap their hands. Because the redeemed of the Lord is seen in the land. Those ransomed by the only begotten Son, those born of the Spirit, filled with his glory, filled with his nature, filled with everything that belongs to the beauty of his life. Hallelujah. Abaki seta ropan, ekika atoshi, mare behefra, mare behefri sotara. Malekana mon zisista. Ha. Name Roman de se de gisoroni. Now you go ahead and receive yourself a bunch of joy right now. Go ahead and receive. Go ahead and begin to open up your packages now. Begin to open up all of your gifts and all of the presents from heaven above. Ha. Oh, that joy unspeakable. Woo! I got joy. I got it. Did you? Oh, what I always wanted. Joy unspeakable. And full of peace. Woo! Peace that passes understanding. Looky here. Woo-hoo! Love that goes beyond all knowledge. Oh, my goodness. This is more than I can think or ask. This is way beyond anything I deserve. I can't believe you got all this for me, Lord. I can't believe you got all this for me. Lord, you daily load me up with all these things. Hallelujah. Come on, shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord on the earth, let us sing. Majesty, praise to the King. Woo-hoo! Shout to the Lord on the earth, let us sing. Majesty, power, praise to the King. Hallelujah. The one who's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the everlasting, the Almighty God. Hallelujah. 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 Woo-hoo. Some of you need to get up and dance around a little bit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo. Hallelujah. Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Oh, come, hold him, born the King of nations. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we give thanks unto you. Almighty God, let the praises of your people fill the earth, O God. Let the praises of the Lord fill your earth right now. Let the high praises of the Lord fill your earth right now. Let the high praises of the living God fill your life right now. Hallelujah. 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 Hey, break past the crowd and break past the things that distract you and come and behold him. Break past all the things that would hold you back and enter into this realm of divine grace and glory and begin to worship him with song, with a praise, with a spiritual song, praying with the Spirit and singing with the Spirit, praying with the understanding and singing with the understanding also. Hallelujah. Oh, Father, we adore you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, bless on Bratea. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, just have a seat for a few minutes. Maybe we can get you over into a realm of divine power and glory by the Word and by the Spirit, and you'll begin to worship better. And then you'll find that spot, and you won't move out of it. You know, you'll get yourself in the right spot. You'll get your place where where all the riches are, and you won't go looking somewhere else. You just stay right there in the riches. Hallelujah. I want you to open your Bibles in John chapter 1, verse 51, and talk to you a little bit there. Because, dear people, religion will prevent you from ever seeing Jesus. Your own ideology will always prevent you from seeing Jesus. I know when you think about, here's the greatest event that has ever happened in the universe. The Redeemer is now made flesh. He leaves the glory and the comforts of the riches of all that he has always known, being the creator of all things, and I'm certain there was no lack. And as the Christmas carol says, he laid his head down on a hay. There was no room for him, no crib for a bed. He subjects himself to such a place of poverty, as it were,
that he has for a bed, a bale of hay. Now, understand, God did not open up the heavens so that the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees, could see the glory of God being made manifest in the earth. He didn't. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven of the joyous celebration of angels singing, "Unto you this day is born in the city of David in Bethlehem, Christ the Savior." Who was that revealed to? Was that revealed to the scholars of scholars, the religious leaders, the people who all day long was memorizing scripture? Was it heard in the temple of the Lord where God had established praise and worship? No, it wasn't. Why? Because they cast out such an interaction, a relationship with the Lord, and replaced it with all of their religion and with all of their ideology. The only people that were able to hear the manifestation and see the manifestation, the tokens of God's divine intervention into the life of men, the greatest event that ever happened, was people who were humble and broken, shepherds in the field tending their sheep. They didn't have anything else to rely on. They didn't have all their brilliance to rely upon. The heavens could not be opened to them. There was no ability for those who believed that they could see, those who believed that they understood the things of God, those that were so set in their practice to be able to begin to see the witness that Father was giving of his Son. He had to come to people who knew nothing, whose hearts were wide open to receive. They didn't have a bunch of ideology and philosophy. They didn't have a bunch of things that really is just occupies the Christian church today probably more than we're willing to recognize and to really take notice of, how filled up we are with ourselves, how filled up we are with the interest of the world. God has given a life, and very few people want to lay hold on the life that he's given. They're willing, for one reason or the other, to submit themselves to something that is far less than the life that Christ Jesus modeled for us. They're willing to just basically, kind of acquiesce to what everybody else is doing. Their ideology of what is successful is a head count. Because their ideology or because their belief of what's successful is a number of people in the meeting, they'll never be able to discern the tokens and the manifestations of the moving of the Spirit. And because they can't discern it, there's no way that they can ever cooperate with it, because their heart and their affections are set upon other things than a little baby in a manger. God, the Messiah, is not going to be born in a manger. He's going to be the king of the world. He's going to be born in an ivory palace. He's going to be born in the halls of the mighty, in the halls of those who rule the world and at that time ruled Israel. That's what people thought. That's what men thought. That's not what God did. No, you could think that, why did Father just have a star shining? Why didn't he just, open up the heavens and with a great shout say, "Today, my son is born, everybody take notice"? Why was it that it was just a few shepherds that could hear, a couple of wise men who could understand and perceive and discern the signs of the time? Because there was just a few people that were willing, number one, to be in a place where they could receive and hear from God, because they weren't already sidetracked with all their beliefs and all their religion and all their ideology. The Pharisees were so filled up with their own self-worth and their own belief and their own, their own system of approaching God. They had a means by which they could make themselves righteous, and they had a means by which they could receive honor and esteem from men. Why should they be interested in a Messiah, a baby, God incarnate, the Almighty God born in the manger? It didn't fit into any of their doctrine and any of their theology to begin with, so they were already blinded. They were already blinded by their preconceived ideas. And I want you to think about this, because Father would so desire to open up the heavens to you so that your eye can see, so that your ears can hear, and so that your hearts can understand what Father has prepared for you and me, a life
that you and I have got to hunger after and thirst after and lay hold of. And yeah, will there be a lot of opposition? And will there be a lot of interference? Or will there be a lot of religion? Will there be a lot of ideologies? Will there be a lot of scholars that come along and Pharisees of Pharisees that come along and the people who have, you know, great supposed success based upon the number of people in their church, the number of houses or buildings that they built, the amount of influence that they have, and try to lead you and direct you in another way? Absolutely. But only the people who are really just, they're just hungry for God. And I don't know, I don't really know the disposition of the shepherds, other than that we're just in a place where they weren't filled with all the pomp and circumstance and self-worth that men can stuff themselves full of. You know, when you walk around and you really truly believe you know everything about God and how it's supposed to work and how the system, you know, develops and how the Spirit of God moves, you know, you never can really receive from God. You can't. You'll never be able to move with the wind of the Spirit so long as you think you know where the wind's blowing from and where it's going to. You'll never be able to move with the wind of the Spirit. There has to be a place of quiet rest, a place where you're just waiting for the intervention of God in your life. You're looking for something that you don't already have. You're needy for something that you know God's willing to supply. And because you're there in that place, and now you're hungry for the things that only Father can give, now you're in a place where, you know, you ask Him for a piece of bread, you don't end up with a stone. So many people have come to Jesus and they remain thirsty. That a thirst that Jesus said, when you come to me, you'll never have again. When you receive the gift that I have for you. So many people have replaced the water that Christ Jesus wants to give us of the Spirit of life with just religious ideology. And religious ideology will never make you an overcomer. You'll still always be thirsty for sin. You'll never know what it means to love righteousness and hate iniquity. You'll never understand how to take and receive the gift of righteousness, that you might learn how to walk in righteousness. You'll never understand the mercy that He heaps on us continually in the midst of our failure, in the midst of our disobedience, in our midst of our inability to understand, unless you're willing to stay there before His presence and say, God, only You can make of me what You purpose me to be. And look at what He's done in order to sew that all together, in order to frame that all up, in order to establish that. That's what the whole of Christmas is all about, that Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, became flesh to bring you and I into the realms of heaven. He left heaven and came into the realms of the earth to take you and I out of the realms of earth and translate us over into the realms of the heavenly. Not something that happens after we die, something that happens right now, that then we get to enjoy after we die. Because first the resurrection has to happen inside for a resurrection to happen outside. First, there has to be a wellspring springing up, supplying us. We've got to allow that as being the means by which we're satisfied, rather than looking for other things out there in the world to satisfy us. Because as long as there is that mixture, and as long as there is that compromise, we can never have really what God has supplied to us. You know, when you think about the Pharisees, Jesus didn't look. There was no announcement from heaven to the Pharisees. They were all in the temple, divoting, praying, crying out to God. Nothing. They got nothing. The shepherds in the field have a heavenly choir singing Christmas carols to them, telling them, go right now, you got, and showing them exactly where to go, saying, He's just been born. Go and worship Him. God, it's like God didn't even want any Pharisees there. And I have to ask myself, Lord, am I stuff full of my own preconceived ideas about who You are, so certain that I know better than anyone else that it results in my inability to respond to You, see You, and move with You, and lay hold upon the life that You very clearly said is mine to have? Can you hear me? Yes. Think about it, dear people. There is a lot of compromises and a lot of settling out among God's people for a lifestyle, for a disposition, for a way of living that is far less than what God has described that He has given to us in this gift supplied to us through His only begotten Son. So many people are willing to worship
a baby in a manger, but they're not willing to worship the Savior on the cross. There are people that are willing to worship the Savior on the cross, but they're not willing to worship the one who raised up from the dead and defeated death, hell, and the grave, overthrew sin and all of its lust and all of its evil iniquity and all of the influence of the satanic. They'll worship him in pretense, but when it comes to the moment of time where Satan is imposing upon them and pushing upon them his own desires, they go ahead and just worship Satan. They go ahead and involve themselves in a demonic activity. I'm going to tell you right now, I believe with all of my heart that obedience is just as much of worship as anything that you and I could ever participate in. And maybe we might even actually evaluate obedience as even a greater dimension of worship. Because what's going to happen here is Jesus is going to tell us that if we'll obey him, if we'll just love him and we'll obey him, and if we obey him, he's going to come and manifest himself to us. So are you looking in John chapter 1, verse 51? And, you know, here Nathanael doesn't be, his eyes aren't open. His ears aren't open, so to speak, as it were. So, his heart does not understand. But now the gospel is going to be ministered to him, not with the words of men's wisdom, as Paul described in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, but a demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power. And now Christ Jesus is going to minister by the gifts of the Spirit to him, the word of knowledge, and say, Nathanael, I saw you when you were underneath this tree. I saw you sitting there underneath the fig tree. People want to speculate what was going on. It's not necessary. What was going on, that dynamic of the word of knowledge that was taking place and that interaction that was taking place between Nathanael and Jesus at that moment was enough right there to break off the chains of bondage from off Nathanael's life, the doubt, the unbelief. It was enough to break off whatever it was in his way and open up his heart to receive, and suddenly begin to have a major transition from can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Because obviously he's referring to the scripture. You try to find in the scripture where Jesus came forth out of Nazareth. You can't. And so his eyes are blinded because he's going to lock God within a framework of that which he can understand. It is, you can distill it, but it is very difficult to distill it, that he came forth from Nazareth. Very, very difficult to distill it. So he's saying, what promise from God is ever going to come out of Nazareth? Philip is going to say, come and see. You're going to have an encounter. There's going to be a manifestation. There's going to be a revelation to you. If you're willing just to respond to this simple witness of the Spirit of the Lord that Philip is giving as he's talking to Nathanael, who ultimately becomes the one known as Bartholomew. He comes, Jesus speaks to him. He encounters the supernatural, the moving of the Spirit, and immediately his response changes. He now has a revelation that a lot of people don't have even to this day that study the scripture among the Jewish people. Suddenly he realized that the Messiah is more than a man. He says, Son of God, not Son of David. Look at that. You see that? You're the Son of God. So, you know, that's why it leads me to believe that he was there underneath the fig tree and he was there reading Zechariah chapter 6. He was there reading. All of a sudden, the Messiah is not just a king of Judah. He is a royal priest. He's a temple builder. He's beginning to see things about the revelation of God, the incarnation of Almighty God. His name is called Emmanuel. You begin to see his name is Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, Everlasting Father. He begins to behold that a virgin shall encompass a man. He begins to understand some things by the Spirit of the Lord. Obviously, he's there talking with God. The Lord Jesus is right there in the midst of it somehow by the Spirit of the Lord. His Spirit is with him there as he's asking these questions to God. He's addressing them not only to the Father, but he's addressing them to the Redeemer who's there to redeem him, to ransom him. And so Jesus responds to Nathanael. He says to him,
He said, because of these things you believe, he said, I tell you, from this day onward, he said, you shall see the heavens open, and you shall, and I want you to underscore that, you shall see the heavens open. Just, if you got a highlighter, highlight that. If you got a pen, underline it. You shall see the heavens open, and you shall see angels descending, ascending and descending from the Son of Man. God made flesh. God made unto the same sinful likeness of you and me in order to bring us into a place where we can make a transition from just seeing the natural earthly realm to beholding that which is heavenly. I just want to just spend a little time talking to you about the reality that this morning you could actually encounter an open heaven. You could encounter the revelations of God that you've been praying about, that you've been reading about, that Christ Jesus died and rose again and ascended up into a heavenly realm for you and I to see. Suddenly you won't just be reading, you know, that you're alive together with Him, that you're raised up together with Him, and that you're seated in a heavenly realm. Suddenly you begin to behold yourself in that place and in that position, and the whole dynamics of your life changes. Jacob was able to peer into the open heavens. In Genesis chapter 28, we see there he is in a place called Bethel. He lays down to take some rest, get a night's sleep. And in a vision, and really the Hebrew word for vision is actually a window, and it means to peer into another realm. Here there was a window open to him, as it were. You know, it's like John says in Revelation chapter 4, suddenly I was caught up in the Spirit. Jesus says, I am the door. Yes. I'm the doorway in. Yes. I want you to come into a realm called the heavenly. He says, to Paul describes him and says, we've been translated out of the kingdoms of this world into the kingdom of the dear Son, a translation, an ability to make a shift, to no longer live after the natural understanding, no longer live after human perception. He sees angels ascending and descending. He sees God Almighty standing there declaring who He is. He's saying, my goodness, here I've been in the house of God all this time and did not know it. It's Jacob's revelation that, God's right here. Even though we don't perceive Him, because all of our senses are caught in a world that is designed and fashioned by the realms of darkness to bring deception, to bring a veil, so that the eyes cannot see, the ears cannot hear, and neither that can the heart understand. Father's drawing us. He's declaring to us things by the Word and by His Word and by His Spirit to draw us to a place to simply say, Lord, I want to see. Lord, I want to hear. For me, those are the kinds of things that Nathaniel was talking to God about under the fig tree, because there's definitely an interaction there between him and God, because he's saying, I can just hear him say, if you're real, speak to me now. And so now all of a sudden God says to him, Nathaniel, I saw you there asking me to speak to you. As you are thinking about the coming of the Messiah, you were reading about the life that Father has purposed to have, the fall of man, and then the redemption that God has planned. Many people want it just religion. They don't want a transition. They want religion. They do not want an encounter. They want just a place to stop along and have some knowledge and sing a few songs and be able to argue they're biased about God. And Father wants us to have an encounter that produces a communion that causes us to say, I want that kind of life. That's what's happening in Nathaniel. I want that kind of life. You can see, you say, my Lord and my God, you're the Son of God, you know. Rabbi, Master. He said, well, you're going to see something because of this response to the ministry of the Spirit. You're going to begin to see heaven open before you. and angels ascending and descending. And when that begins to happen, suddenly you recognize, wait a minute, I'm not living in the house of men. Wait a minute, I'm not living burdened by all these ideologies and philosophies and theologies and speculations of men. My eyes now see, I behold, I'm in the house of God. This was all created and designed by Him. He is the one with whom we have to do. And all of that stuff and all of those layers are peeled back and become less, and even not only less of an influence, become no influence at all. That's called clean escaped. That's called no longer in darkness, but now living in light. That's called now having received power to be an overcomer, the ability to deal with the enemy of your soul that wants to destroy you. Suddenly, no longer vexed and compromised by all the darkness, so you can begin to shine with the light of His glory, where your just passions begin to burn, where you want to lay hold on the life, that you're not willing to settle out and compromise along the way. You're not willing somehow to just stop with what you have and say good enough and be satisfied, or even allow things that you know are contrary to God to be in your life. There's always this passion, this cry, you have given something to me, it's mine, and I want to fully lay hold on it. I want to have it. Elijah's servant could not even begin to imagine how it was possible for him to participate with this prophet that he was following when the Assyrian mighty men are getting ready to come and kill them, are pursuing them, seeking their life, because it's been now reported that the Assyrian king cannot do anything. He cannot make any strategy of war. He cannot come up with any plans, except that there's a man of God called Elijah who already knows it all, because he can hear what's being said in the secret chamber. A man who is living in an open heaven. The heavens were open unto Ezekiel, and he began to see the visions of God. You read about that in the first chapter of Ezekiel. This is something that is said over and over again, where somebody begins now to not just live in a realm of the intellect, not to just live in the realm of the gnosis, the knowledge of what men's ability can begin to put together and perceive, and logic can ultimately, and experience along with that logic, will enable you to comprehend. Now you have an encounter, not a comprehension. An encounter. There's very few people on Christmas Day that are going to have an encounter. Christmas has become about, I heard somebody say, this is a very important family day. It's nothing to do with family day in that respect. It has to do with the worship of God, of His mercy and of His grace that brought, that intervened, that rent the heavens and came down, that intervened in a rebellious, sinful life of mankind who wanted nothing really to do with God. They were satisfied with the religion. I mean, the Pharisees started off with Ezra and with Nehemiah. They were called the separated ones. They were the people who were the tremblers, the Haredi. They were the ones who fashioned themselves after Daniel. Oh, that we could have that same kind of response from God and favor to God gave to Daniel on our life. So what we're going to do is we're going to make a religion out of his relationship. You hear me? Can you hear me? We're going to make a religion out of his relationship. Your religion will never get you what the relationship that Daniel had with Father. It will never get, your religion will never get you the relationship that Jesus Christ modeled for us and said, the same relationship I have, you get to have, because your whole life is now in me, but you've got to lay hold on me. I'm going to give you the ability to see me. I'm going to give you the ability to see a star. Not the heavens roll back and God the Father sitting upon the throne and seraphims flying around worshiping Him and the great crystal sea of glass before the throne and all the majesty and all the splendor. I'm going to let you see a star. I'm going to let you see some little perception of the fact that I have intervened in your life. You got to be searching to make something out of a star. You got to be hungry. Huh? Just think about the little tokens that God gave to declare and reveal the greatest event in the history of men. The little teeny tokens. You have to be desperately seeking so that your perception could be and senses could be heightened
to that degree that you would be able to make something out of a star. And as far as I'm concerned, it's very probable that those guys from that area of Babylon had gained that kind of insight from Daniel, who became the master of the wise men during his day. It's very probable that that's where this all came from, because I'm going to tell you right now, Zoroastrianism is nothing you want to be involved in. Nothing you want to be involved in. Absolutely. Zoroastrianism is the worship of Ahura Mazda, which is another name for Lucifer, the shining one. Huh? No, this was a unique group of people. I don't see them as Zoroastrian, which most people today, many scholars today, say, well, the wise men were Zoroastrians. Zoroastrians? They couldn't be Zoroastrians. They worship Ahura Mazda. There's no way. No, this is a unique group of wise people. These were a unique group of magi. A unique group of magi. Huh? Somehow influenced by the chief of all wise men, who knew the secrets, who had a relationship with God that allowed him to understand dreams that weren't even told him. I mean, that's when you know you got the right interpretation. The king wasn't stupid. Right. So if I tell him the dream, I'm going to have every kind of interpretation underneath the sun. And then this is going to be, which one do I want to pick from? I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to find out somebody who really knows dreams. I'm going to demand that they, first of all, tell me what my dream was. And then after, if they can tell me what my dream was, then the interpretation is true. But there was somebody who had a relationship. What Daniel had with God can't even touch what Jesus had in an earthly body. Somebody said, oh, well, we're men. He was a man. Oh, we're just human beings. He became a human being. People want to equate human being with sinners. Oh, God, save us sinners in our hour of need. He will, and make you a saint so that you can be called your holiness. Her holiness, Ann Spitzbergen. Her holiness, Summer. Not just one person. Holiness. Holiness, because God has imparted to us a gift of holiness that we might learn holiness. Righteousness that we might learn righteousness. But not if you're going to make a religion out of this relationship. You never get to see nothing. Heavens will not be open to you. God's principle of understanding how to have the heavens open to you, because it's opened around Jesus. He's the doorway into the realms of the supernatural. He's the doorway into the realms of the eternal. He's the doorway into the realms of everything that belongs to vision and prophecy and revelation of Father. God purposed and was pleased to embody in him all of his fullness. So everything about heaven and eternity is manifested in Christ Jesus. And he says, come behold me. Oh, come, let us adore him. We're saying we're going to come and behold him. We're saying we're going to come and see him. We got to move beyond the veil of imaginations and move beyond the veil of rational theology and ideology and philosophy. And you have to have an encounter. The servant of Elijah goes, my goodness, what are you talking about? You and I, up against the entire Syrian army, and you're not worried? You're not concerned? Elijah goes, no, I'm not at all. Because I see something you can't see. Now, a lot of people would go, I can't believe the arrogance of my pastor. He's just always putting himself up higher than me, the rest of us. Amazing. I'm going to another meeting. I'm going to go to another church. True, the dynamics of everything you read in the scripture, you encounter one way or the other. You and I encounter one way or the other. We encounter probably most of what Israel encountered to some degree, not in a practical, real way, where you're so thirsty your tongue is swollen up in your mouth and all of a sudden you get bitter water instead of sweet water. But nonetheless, all of us still encounter in many ways the things that Israel encountered, and many of our responses are the same as theirs were in the wilderness as we sit and read about them, wondering why they could have acted like that and how they could have made those choices. We have many of the same things happen in our lives. And always there is God standing there saying, I want to reveal myself to you. I've got an inheritance for you. Can you trust me? Will you walk with me? Will you believe me? Do you really need garlics and leeks more than me? Did garlics and leeks really, is that really better than the supernatural heavenly bread that I want to give you? I can't imagine what happened to the people who were delighting in the heavenly bread. They take the heavenly bread and it feels like and tastes like an entire lamb dinner. Like an entire, and they take another piece of manna and it was like, you know, blueberry pie and vanilla ice cream. But the people who were just totally upset about the fact that they got manna bread, they got manna stew, they got manna kebab, they got manna, and all of that's it. Manna, all I get is manna. And they detested manna. I'm sure it tasted terrible. They weren't enjoying that which Father had supplied, the table that he had spread. They were locked up in their senses and what they desired within the framework of a limited natural life that's about to come to an end. And their God is standing at the door of their heart saying, I want you to understand, you live forever. And I'm inviting you to come in to the realm in which I exist in. I'm inviting you into this love. I'm inviting you into this life. I'm inviting you into this goodness. People say no to God. They say no to God. I don't want the life. I don't want the goodness. I don't believe that you exist. I'm going to come over here and I'm going to imbibe myself in sin and iniquity and engage in this whole ideology that you don't even exist while I look at that which is impossible to exist without you. While I breathe in and out the breath that you breathe in to man and made a living soul, which not a human being in physiological science can even begin to comprehend. Not a human being, not the brightest human being in physiological chemistry or biochemistry in medical science can even begin to comprehend the power of this breath, its presence and the impact of it and its absence. And it was breathed into us the very existence, as it were, the very life and moving of God in the daily lives of the people who hate him the most. He really is closer than the air that you breathe. But you can't perceive him unless you have an encounter, unless you're in a place to have an encounter. Unless you're in a disposition to him. If you're preoccupied with religion, you're never going to be able to hear the angels singing. Right. If the Pharisees weren't preoccupied with religion, they could have heard the angels singing. If the scholars of scholars and the mighty men and the lawyers and the doctors of the law weren't preoccupied with all of the things that they believed they knew about God, they could have heard the angels singing. Glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth. God's goodwill towards men. Today, God Almighty has been born. Today, in the city of David, is born unto you Christ the King. People have got to come from other countries. Kings from other countries. Wise men from other nations. Hundreds and hundreds of miles away, because the king of that nation and the kings around those nations had no ability to perceive. They were preoccupied with their own beliefs and with their own ideas and with their own wants and with their own wishes. They were stuffed full of everything that human beings can teach one another about God. All the shepherds were doing was making sure the sheep made it through the night without getting taken out by a wolf. All they understood is that I've got to take care of these sheep because this is our livelihood. Their wool is our clothing. Their meat is our food. Huh? Yeah. We're the people of God. We don't really know what all that means, but we know that someday he's going to come and he's going to rescue us and he's going to save us. And in that disposition, they heard the heavenly choir. The heavens were open to them. When the prophet Elijah's servants, when the heaven was opened, suddenly stands back and he sees, wait a minute. No. Now I get it. Now I get what David was saying. The earth is filled with his glory. Now I get what the prophets were saying.
heaven and earth is filled with his glory. Because all of a sudden, he begins to see the angel of the Lord and the horsemen thereof. He sees that there is another existence, that there is another world parallel to the world that he's living in. Suddenly he realizes, wait, I've been in the house of God all this time and I did not know it. There is a transition that God desires for us to have. The other night I was experiencing something from the Lord, an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, where just that electrifying presence where you feel like your whole being is just fragmenting. It's indescribable. You can't even begin to describe it. It's just the indescribable encounters with who he is, just his person. Just because you got just a little bit, you were willing to just be a little bit more hungry, a little bit more desirous to know him, to serve him, to please him, to walk with him. He's saying, all the full manifestation of God is revealed right here. You're going to see angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man today. That's not just for Nathaniel. That's for us right now. He's telling us that all of heaven is encapsulated in him, encountered through him. All of the heavens, everything that belongs to God, the fullness of the Godhead, bodily in person. If you had a monitor about how satisfied you are with the life that you're pursuing and what you know about God, what would that monitor look like? Religious people are the most argumentative people on the planet. They know more about God than anybody else and have less revelation of him in their life. Why is that? Same reason the Pharisees couldn't hear the heavenly choir. What happens when all of a sudden we begin to understand what the prophet was saying when God spoke to him and said, you're going to build a house for me? I'm not interested. You know? That's the response of men, Peter, James, and John. They get there, be there with the Jesus in the Mount of Transfiguration. The heavens are open before them. They actually get to see what Jesus is really looking like the whole time. That men's eyes can't perceive because they're deceived and blinded by another realm. Suddenly, they begin to see, wait a minute, the whole time his clothes are lit up with the glory of heaven. The whole time his face is shining with the glory of heaven. Listen, Father talking. There's Elijah. There's Moses. What do they want to do? They want to do a building project. Let us build 3 tabernacles. They want to commemorate the thing. They want to make an icon of it. They want to make a religion, something to bow down to, something to genuflect to, something to go around and talk about. Well, I know more than you do, and this is, I agree with you, or I disagree with you, and all this other nonsense. Let me see God. That's what Paul said. I don't want to hear your doctrine. I don't hear your ideology. I want to see God. I'm going to come see if Christ is in you. I'm going to see God. I want to see God in you. I want to see if you had an encounter with God or if you're nothing more than just a religious Pharisee and the Sadducee and the person who's a scholar of scholars and believe you know everything about God. You're going to miss God. Because here they are. Can you imagine? They're in the temple all crying out, oh God, reveal yourself, reveal yourself. There, Jesus standing there. You know, turning over the tables of the money changers. Huh? Opening up the eyes of the blind. They're still standing there in the temple going, oh God, come and deliver us. Jesus is doing mighty acts, mighty works, by great signs and wonders. The power of God is upon him to deliver everyone tormented and vexed by the powers of darkness, to open up the eyes of the blind, both physically and especially spiritually, to cause the deaf to hear, both physically and especially spiritually. And they're there, oh God, when will you come and deliver us? Oh God, when will you answer our prayer? And there's the high priest offering incense. Meanwhile, God Almighty is walking around the precincts of the temple. And they're saying, hey, get that guy out of here. They can't see Jesus because of the things they think they know. They can't perceive the movings of God because there's no more hunger. Their hunger is stuffed full of their religion. And you have to ask yourself, I have to ask myself, How much am I like that? Because if I'm not moving in the life that God has made available to me, if I somehow have less of a dimension than what the Word of God describes, it's because I'm stuck somewhere. It's because I'm stuck somewhere on the value of myself. Hey, quit making this all about you. Take up your cross and follow Jesus. I was telling Daniel the other day, someday in the future, if God allows me, I'm going to make a layman's translation of the Bible. Instead of just say deny yourself, I'm going to say, hey, quit making it all about you. Hallelujah. Take up your cross. Quit making it all about you and start doing what Jesus did when he laid his life down for the world. Hallelujah. He's an amazing God. Look at the transition that takes place in Elijah's servants. Suddenly goes from doubt and unbelief, man, we're in trouble. This ain't going to work out. We're dead. What's two guys against the mighty Syrian army, one of the great armies of his day? Suddenly, his eyes are open in the heavenly realm, and he's going, we're good. I mean, he's like, suddenly faith goes to a realm of like, those poor tens of thousands of troops, they have not a chance to stand against us. Suddenly, I'm living in another realm based on a whole new set of unique conditions. The tables have been turned. The value of what I have has now been realized. I have all heaven backing me up. I got God Almighty on my side. Amen. Jesus Christ standing here, Father God standing here, Holy Ghost there and there at the same time kind of thing. And I've got all the angels of heaven surrounding them, and the cherubims aren't moving anywhere that Father's not there, because they're there making sure that nobody messes with him, kind of thing. And I got a great company. You've got a great company. But if you've not had an encounter, if you're stuck in religion, you're never going to be able to begin to discern and perceive the small tokens that God uses to get this whole thing started in our life that then causes us to pursue him and ultimately find ourselves right in the big middle of his divine exploits. All heaven is revealed to the person of Jesus. And he says, if you obey me, if you love me, you keep my commandments, you'll do what I say to do. And my Father and I will come and make our abode with you. And I will manifest myself to you. What do you want? Your religion or a relationship? Relationship. What do you want? Ideology or an encounter? What do you want? Just want to live in the framework of your logic and your expression and the scriptures you think you know? Give me a break. Or do you want to have the revelation of the living word, which every word is spoken so that you and I have the very revelation of the living word, the only begotten Son, Christ Jesus, who is manifest to us in the flesh to ultimately be revealed in us in the flesh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, the great baptizer in the Holy Ghost. You know, when Pentecost came, one of the great things that is the greatest thing, outside of the incarnation of Jesus Christ into flesh to bear our sins and to be our great high priest to this very day, was the ministry that he began when he poured out the Holy Ghost and power. And people want to sit around and make a theology out of it. They want to make an ideology about it. They want to say, they want to parse out what God the Holy Ghost can do and cannot do. When the Lord showed us how it works, on the day of Pentecost, they all began to speak with other tongues. All at the same time. 120 approximately of them. And more than 3,000 people all at the same time heard what they were saying. Try that. Try that. Mr. and Mrs. Logic. Set that up for yourself. Do a little experiment. See how 120 people all speaking at the same time can be heard by more than 3,000 people and understood in more than 12 languages. Holla! Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Give me a break. You think you know how the wind is, where the wind is coming from and where it goes? You'll never be able to move with God. Huh? He does what he wants in the lives of hungry, desperate people to say, God, I've got to have what you've given. I want to open up the gifts that you've supplied. I want to understand how to move with you. I want to know you. I believe that you became flesh for me. I believe that you are God. I believe that you are the Savior. I believe that you're the Redeemer. I believe that you are the life. I believe that you are everything that I've ever desired. And I need you and I want you and I want to know you. Do whatever you need to do. Move in every way you want to move. I don't care. I just want you. Now you can have Pentecost.
Now you can all speak with tongues as the Holy Ghost gives you utterance all at the same time. Now you won't just pray with the understanding, but you'll pray with the Spirit also. Hallelujah. Now you just won't sing with the understanding, but you'll sing with the Spirit also. And Paul made it very clear in 1 Corinthians 14, he was talking about tongues. Everybody singing in tongues. Everybody praying in tongues. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Different from a tongue that is given in a message to be interpreted. Hallelujah. And every one of you can do it one by one, not just two or three. All the people that come up with those things are the people stuffed filled with their religion, and they never have the move of God in their life, and all they do is propagate strife. All they do is propagate strife, and it happens not just with the Pharisees, not with just the Sadducees, not with just the scholars of scholars, not with the doctors of the law only, but with religious people all over the planet right now, stopping and preventing the encounter with God, an open heaven, the moving of the Spirit, the reception of all the Father wants to do, because what he's going to do, he's going to do through his people, us, you and me. It's through us, or it's not going to get done. Are you going to tell the Holy Ghost how he's going to move and how he's going to do it? Why don't you first raise a few people from the dead? Huh? Why don't you first begin to move in the word of knowledge and greater accuracy? Huh? Why don't you first just start doing a few of the things that Jesus did? I'm not even talking about doing greater works. I'm just talking about just do a few of the things he did. Then start giving us your opinion. But what happens is when you begin to encounter truth and you recognize, wait a minute, he's called me to lay hold on the light that he himself has and models and showed us, to do his works of power and greater works of power than these, then suddenly you don't know anything. Suddenly you begin hungry. Suddenly you begin to get desperate. Suddenly you begin to say, oh God, I want to know you. Lord, I want to see you. I want to have your deliverance. I want to have your salvation. I want to have the working of your power in my life. Do what you must do. Do what you must do. Whatever needs to be changed in my life, change it. Let your fire burn in my life. There's a fire of judgment. If you really want to understand about the fire of judgment, read about the fire of judgment in Amos. Amos was about the fire of judgment more than any other prophet. You can read about the fire of judgment in Leviticus chapter 10 when the fire fell upon Nadab and Abihu. They just altered worship just a little bit. Just a little. Korah and Dathan, they were also priests, Levites. They were also honorable men, rulers before Moses, chief men among the people. And they said, we also could stand before God. They want to alter things just a little bit. They want to do it their way. There's not going to be a good encounter. There's the judgment of fire. Or there's the fire of approval. That's the fire that came down out of heaven, accepted the offering that was just like God described it's supposed to be. That's the fire that Elijah is able to say, let God who is God answer by fire. That's the fire, hallelujah, of approval. That's the fire that Jesus Christ himself baptizes us in, the Holy Ghost and fire. That's a bombro sitaya. Somebody said, what's about the fire? That is what Father himself dwells in. He's God who dwells in the midst of the fire. It's his overcoat. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. An encounter. Now people come to do their Pentecostal genuflex, their religious thing. It's Christmas. And now it is Christmas. That time of the year. It's sad. It's sad. It's been marketed and merchandised and turned into something that it's just so sad. God intervened to deliver us from an eternity with the devil, with hate, destruction, darkness. I'm going to tell you right now, just an eternity being with someone who hates you so bad. They cannot stand the sight of you. And you're bunking with them in a 3x3 square cell. In other words, they in your face so much. And they hate you and they're more powerful than you are. And whatever they want to do to you, they do it. That'd be hell enough.
And people live in that sin and that immorality and that lust of the flesh and that lust of the eye and that pride of life. And in the midst of that, they deny everything that is good and beautiful and glorious. And Father says, you choose that. After what I've done for you, then there's nothing for you but an eternal damnation. Go tell them. Go tell them who I am. Noel, that is means proclamation of the Messiah. Go tell them. Go proclaim to them what God has done. God has been made flesh to redeem us, to make himself of no reputation. He didn't stand around and tell people when he was playing football at the age of 21 years old, hey, do you really know who I am? He made himself of no reputation. God made in the flesh to simply die at Calvary's cross. He said, tell them that believe, they shall be saved. They shall be delivered. There'll be a translation from the earthly to the heavenly. They'll get a new heart. They'll get a new spirit. They'll begin to have a nature like me. They'll get filled with my joy. They'll get filled with my love. Everlasting joy will be upon their head. The God's people are not oppressed with sorrow and sadness. There's everlasting joy on their head. They'll walk in this love. This love that God showed us will be in them. It will be made manifest in them. They will not have argument. They will not have sedition. They will not have strife. They will not have division. This is what God says. But if they reject you, if they reject this so great a salvation, if they reject it, and of course, Paul goes on to say neglect. Just neglect it. He says, those that believe should be saved. Those that do not believe, they will be damned. Because God has already set it up. He said, I'm not going to live with hate, murder, arguing, strife, division, people yelling, screaming, destroying one another, oppressing one another. I'm not living with it. It will be ultimately contained and set aside in an eternal prison. Joy to the world. And to me, it is joy to the world. Because I want to live with that mess. I won't live with it in my own home. I don't live with strife. I don't live with somebody who's arrogant. Huh? Always just condescending. Why would you even want to do that? I like love. Yeah. I like a humility. I like servitude. I like submission. I love submission. I love being submitted. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, when you submitted to God, you submitted to everybody. Huh? Come on. When you serve in God, you serve everybody. Huh? When you bow unto your own self, then you serve in nobody. You a god unto yourself. You a demigod, who all-knowing. We call it a Joe-it-all. And you are listening to me? Yeah. Hallelujah. Got to come up with a feminine of that, but nonetheless. Are you hungry?
Yes.
Then you don't know. You don't know. You don't know how. You know about it, but you don't know how to get there. You want it. I want to move with God. I covet to prophesy. I covet when God speaks. Who said it? Was it Obadiah? Could have been Amos. When God speaks, who but can prophesy? I want to be so connected with God that when he speaks, my mouth is wide open prophesying. I covet to do that. Well, I mean, goodness gracious, dear people, come on. If you're satisfied with whatever it is that you think you have, you're never going to be hungry for the things that God says is available to you. Or somehow you sought them for a few days and it didn't happen the way that you thought it should, so you just gave up and redefined God's word. The encounter cannot come. Because you just went and imprisoned yourself in religion and ideology and philosophy. You just imprisoned yourself into another kind of faith, into another kind of expectation. No longer do you have for a passion that which God designed, which he proclaimed. So no longer are you waiting on him. You're satisfied with what you got. You're satisfied with your belief system that you learned from watching a YouTube. Or that you Googled. You Googled it. You Googled what God said by his spirit. And now you bought in with whatever Google said and shut off the moving of God. Sad, isn't it? It's worse than that. That's the highlight of it. That's the more intellectual pursuit, a YouTube and a Google. And now you know more than all of your teachers because you have Google. That's not what David said. I know more than all of my teachers Because his delight was in God. It was a relationship. I was delighted. I'm over here delighted. I'm over here delighted. I'm not serving with, you know, reluctance and regrets and obligation. I wake up in the morning to God dancing the Lord. See, make a theology out of that. I wake up in the morning to him rejoicing over me and writing songs about me. Because he loves me so much and his delights are with the sons of men. Because if he loved me so much that when I was alien by wicked works, when I was separated from him and removed far away from him, in darkness and transgression, he commended his love towards me. If God spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all, how shall he not also by him freely give us all things? I feel more of the demonic on Christmas Day than any of the remaining 364 days out of the year. More of the demonic. Why? Because of the power of religion. Stinking power of religion. And once you discern it, you'll hate it in your own life. You'll hate it in your own life. And there you begin to get broken. And then you'll see the things that have imprisoned you. You'll see the things that have imprisoned you when God has set you free. You'll begin to engage. Suddenly food won't be so valuable to you anymore. And whether or not your rate of metabolism might be lowered or whatever, don't even mean, because you're meaning anything, because your value of your life is meaningless. You don't care that whether you have less muscle mass after you're done. You don't care whether or not you have dark rings under your eyes and whether your heart works the same or your liver works the same. Don't even mean nothing. Something bigger than all of that, because you had an encounter. Your eyes were open. You were able in this hunger for God and the seeking God to discern the smallest little token that pointed you to the invasion of God in the midst of your life. And you lay hold on it. You lay hold on it. How many of the shepherds followed Jesus after that event that day? Would you have? If all of a sudden you're out tending sheep and you hear, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill towards men unto you, this day is born in the city of David, Christ the Savior. He's right over there. Go see him and worship him. Would have you just stayed there? Say, where are you guys going now? We're following you. And become a crowd just following them around? I don't know. We never hear the shepherds ever again. Maybe the next morning they thought, well, we just had a weird dream. Wow, you mean you had that dream too? We all had the same dream? That was wild. They went back over there and they looked for them. They were already gone. Huh? Because I can tell you right now, if I was Joseph, I wouldn't be staying around in the barn. We've had this baby. Let's go. Are you with me? I wouldn't have got to be there the next day. But, you know, I'm not going to be like camp. Oh, let's just live here. This is a good one. This is a good house. Get out of there. Get out of there. Jesus. Come, let us adore him. You can't come adore him until you know that he's there. You can't come to God unless you know he's there. And when you know he's there, you quit giving him instruction on how he does things. You quit telling him how it is that he runs his show. I could just hear Father listening to everybody talking about what it is he believes. Really? This is amazing. That's what I believe. Oh, that's the way I move? Amazing. Amazing. At least Job had some credentials. You know what I'm saying? He was the wisest, wealthiest, most righteous, most perfect man that existed. He had some credentials to be talking about who God is and how he acts and what, you know, what it is he does when he does it. But you and me sitting around here doing what? Lord help us. Lord help us. God, he's so good. He loves us so much. He draws us with loving kindness and cords of tender mercies.
He desires to open up our eyes and calls us to see what eyes have not seen. But he will only do it with the encounters of the Holy Ghost and power. He desires us to hear what ears have not heard, but he will only do it and can only do it with encounters of the Holy Ghost and power. And those of you who know the scripture know exactly what I'm talking about. And for those of you who don't, I'll help you in just a minute so you know what I'm talking about very clearly from the Word of God. He desires our hearts to understand so that we can perceive and move with him. But he will only do it by the encounters of the Holy Ghost and power. And you're not having no encounters with the Holy Ghost and power in a place of arrogance, being a Joe at all, a person satisfied on your religious ideology, always looking up the dictionary, the meaning of a word. God, the Holy Ghost, is the interpreter. He's the definer. Jesus is the definition. Jesus is the definition, not the dictionary. Jesus' definition, proclamation, revelation, declaration, logos, the word. You want to understand what God's saying? You look at Jesus. You understand what he meant? You look at Jesus. Jesus defines it. He's called us to come and have his life. And so many people are willing to have a religious Jesus life and not the real reality Jesus life. Which one are you? Which one are you? Which one are we? Do we get all upset when somebody begins to tell us, you need to lay hold on eternal life? You need to lay hold on the gift that God has given you? You need to get more hungry, you need to get more thirsty. And the more hungry you get and the more thirsty you get, the less you know. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? I used to know a whole lot more when I was 20. Some of you knew me when I was 20. I knew I could give you an answer for every question you had. I could explain God, define him, and diagram him. I could take a chart and tell you about the eternal past and go take you all the way to tell you about the eternal future and all the events that's going to happen in between. I could do it. And then I had an encounter with God and all that disappeared. Suddenly I didn't know anything. Suddenly I all of a sudden became what? I don't know. Suddenly I became, my response became, instead of giving you a full explanation, my response became, I don't know. And then my response became, I'm hungry. And my response became, I'm thirsty. And then the events begin to unfold and counter. You know, the wisest people on the face of the earth are between the ages of 16 and 32. Wisest people on the earth. If you would like to get some information that comes right out of the realms of men, consult someone 16 to 32. Huh? 34 is not any that much better. But you know what? It's after 32 you start recognizing things aren't going the way I planned. It's much harder to make money than I thought. Success doesn't come as easy as I was certain it would. Suddenly you find yourself right in the midst of doing this, banging your head up against the wall and discovering you're doing it to yourself. First you wondered why you had a headache. Then you realize, wait a minute, I'm doing this to myself. 40 years old, you're looking for other possible alternatives. 40, you're looking for other alternatives. 45, you're giving up. You're settling out. You're not dreaming anymore. You're losing your vision. If you took your 45-year-old self and imposed yourself on your 18-year-old self, you would hate you. The 18-year-old would hate the 45-year-old. And you would say, get away from me. I do not know who you are, and I do not want to talk to you. And your 45-year-old self is trying to reason with you. But you're not going to listen. Something goes way beyond that in our life right now. God, the Holy Ghost, who's eternal, is really working with us. I'll be 58 years old in a couple of months. And I'm more excited about what God is going to do with my life. I have bigger visions and bigger dreams than I had when I was 18 years old because I'm in fast pursuit of the life that has been made available to me in Christ Jesus, and all the riches and all the splendor and all the glory and all the supernatural that goes with it, all the revelation, all the encounters. I am going to function in these works and greater works.
Yes.
I haven't left up. I haven't let up a little bit, even a little bit. I'm righteous even as He's righteous, because I find my existence in Him. I know I'm in Him more than I've ever known it in my life. I'm holy as He is holy because I'm in Him, and I know that more than better than I do have ever known in my life. He's all my righteousness, and I stand complete in Him, and I worship Him. Ah, and I know that better than I've ever known it in my life, and I never come to Him on the basis of who I am. I come to Him on the basis of who He is and what He's done for me, and I know that better than I've ever known it in my life. I never worship Him on the basis of my success or not worship Him on the basis of my failure. All my existence is in Him, and outside of Him there is no acceptance with God. And if you somehow are an approval to yourself, you have fallen from grace. If somehow you measure up in the ideas of what you conceive to be acceptable to God, the Pharisees far outdid you. Far outdid you. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Are you stuck in your religion? Because if you are, you can't have an encounter. Are you stuck in the idea of your own self-worth? If you are, you can't see. The movings of the Spirit that will open your eyes. I just bow before Him. I just take another sip of communion. I have myself some more heavenly bread. Hallelujah. I've discovered a long time ago, people are overwhelmed by the spirit of darkness and by temptation simply because they were not willing to involve themselves in spiritual food, in communion and relationship. They weren't willing to give themselves to the reading of the Word. They were willing to go whole long weeks, days, weeks. They weren't willing to come into a communion. They just had a religious prayer. They didn't know how to interact with Him and be overwhelmed by His presence till the joy hits you. Even in the tired state, you find a place you're so tired you can't even keep your eyes open, but you press in, and all of a sudden in the reading of the Word, just communion with the Lord, you just get refreshed. Huh? People still yawning in church.
Oh, no.
It's true. All over the world, yawning in church. Father wants us to come and behold Him.
Amen.
Oh, come ye, come ye. Now to Bethlehem. Which is the house, it's a Hebrew word for the house of God. Behold the King of nations. All nations desire Him. We've received the first tokens of revelation of who He is. We've received the movings of the Spirit, which are so precious and sacred to me. And I say with the Lord Jesus, you can talk about me, and you can talk about Dad, but you talk about the Holy Ghost, and we're going to slap you across the head and kick you out, and you will never be welcomed back in. And that's what He said, my layman's translation. True. It will not be forgiven. We will not forgive you. We will not forgive you. You start talking about the Holy Ghost. We will not forgive you. How many of you will sit in churches with and fathers already say, I will not forgive you. And then they're doing just like the Pharisees. Oh God, we are your servants. We serve you night and day. Jesus is there, and they can't even recognize Him. He's demon-possessed. It's time to get real with God. Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He is near. I just want to read that to you in closing here. Isaiah 55. Isaiah chapter 55. I want to start at verse 5. If you've never read my little booklet called Having His Thoughts, it's posted on the website. You should read it. Isaiah chapter 55. Hear the word of the Lord. Verse 6. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. He's near. He's here. He's near unto us. He's God in the midst of us. He's Emmanuel. You just can't sing Emmanuel, Emmanuel, and not be feeling he's in me. He's in me. God is in me. He dwells in me. He dwells with us. Emmanuel, he's here. Faith sees him, knows that he exists, and that he's a rewarder, that this relationship is going to result in me waking up with his likeness. Me finding this place where it was sadness and sorrow, finding this joy in this life, because I'm not willing to let up on the pursuit of this one who was born, Christ the Savior, who I've had an encounter with. I've seen the tokens. I saw the witness of it. God's subtle signs. That is boisterous proclamation. Subtle signs that only the desperate can discern. It's always that way. Because that's where he sorts it out. That's how he sorts it out. From the beginning to the end. It's a star. It's a sign. Something that's easily disqualified. Easily forgotten. Easily explained away. But to the discerning, the people that are desperate, those who want to know God. Those are real and sincere, because God's not interested in insincere relationships. He wants real relationships, true relationships. Truth. It's truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden parts, he shall make us to know wisdom. He says, let the wicked forsake his way. And if there's anything that defines what it means to seek the Lord, if there's anything that defines what it means to call upon his name, what happens? Religion explains it away and says, yes, we're all sinners and we're going to sin more or less every day and we're all imperfect. And that's their excuse to be involved in the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And they will find themselves eternally in a place called the lake of fire because they had pleasure in unrighteousness, whose damnation is just. That's what Father says. I have a dear friend of mine. You cannot reach him. Cannot reach him. He has no phone. Because he just said, I will not give place to the stuff. I'll have no phone. Come on, man. Some people, I got to have my phone. I got to have my electronics. You're not even making the cut, man. You're not even serious enough with God to not pass by the place where Satan can hook you. You get real with God, and you're not going to make any provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. He will make no provision for the enemy to be able to tempt. You will not pass by it. You will walk. You will go another city around it to prevent. You won't. Come on. Why does God's people want to go to Las Vegas anyways? What's there? It's worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. Nothing can even grow there. The only thing that lives there is the lizard and the spider. The only reason it exists is because the mafia created it. And God's people are running over there for what? They want to look at the architecture? Give me a break. Give me a break. They're going right into the midst of it. They go turn on televisions and they listen to all the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye, and they wonder why they're having such unholy thoughts. Well, I guarantee you, just give yourself the reading of the word, brain fasting, I guarantee you, the all those unholy thoughts won't be plaguing you no more. Well, you come tell me, listen, I'm dealing with a lot of unholy thoughts. You just told me what you've been doing. I don't have to have any discernment or word of knowledge. I know what you've been doing. You've been preoccupying yourself at allowing a bunch of junk to come in. God said, looking people to seek him. Seek the Lord. I'm serious with God. It's not about self-righteousness. I'm just serious with God. I've had an encounter, because this is an encounter. This is a result of an encounter to seek the Lord. Call upon his name while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his ways. Let the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him. Listen, this is who God is. He's a God of mercy. He's a God of grace. He's a God of forgiveness. He's a God of long-suffering. You say, I'm just going to give up. No, the only person who needs to give up around here is God. And he's not going to, because he loves us so much. And he will abundantly pardon.
Come on, man. How can anybody have a defiled conscience when God's going to abundantly pardon? The only way you can have a defiled conscience is because you're not willing to do what's right. Huh? Wisdom speaks to you and you got a greater wisdom. Guess what? You're never going to have an encounter with God. Knowledge speaks to you and you got a greater knowledge. You're never going to be able to know the knowledge of God. You're never going to know the ways of God. Huh? Understanding speaks to you, but you have understanding already. You're never going to have anything but what you already had before you came. Yeah. Even though God shows up, it's not going to make a difference in your life. Because you already see, you already know, you already understand. You have no ability to be led now. No ability to discern. No ability thus to have an encounter. All you will have is religion. All you will have is what man can do. It will never be the supernatural power described by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We've not come with the wisdom of men, lest your faith should be in men and not in God. But we've come with the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Hallelujah. Huh? Because God wants you to see what eyes not see, hear what ears not heard, understand what's never entered the heart of men, because he wants to reveal it to you by the Holy Ghost, by this encounter of the demonstration of the Holy Spirit and power, just like happened with Nathaniel. When you come up against God, you will encounter heaven, power, that which the natural realm can never produce. And my soul demands it, because that's reality. Mm-hmm. All the rest, who knows what it is? What is real is what God is doing. All the rest of it, lies, deceptions, to draw away the hearts of men from the only purpose that we have to live, to seek God, to know him, and to keep his commandments. All the rest is lies, vanity, emptiness, nothingness, so says the preacher. Sum total of the purpose of men. We were created for his praise. Yes. The fish were created to swim. The birds were created to fly. But we were created in Christ Jesus to just worship. Let me see your worship. Let me see the demonstration of the power. I hear Paul say, I hear what you say. I hear all your beliefs and all the things you say you know. But I'm going to come and make a proof of you. I'm not going to hear your words. I'll see your demonstration of power. Hallelujah. Why? Why? Because he's saying it's the proof you've had an encounter with God. It is the proof you're not just religious. If anybody knew about religion, Paul knew. Pharisee of the Pharisees. Sit at Gamaliel's feet. The son of a Pharisee. Concerning the righteousness of the law, blameless. Pretty radical. But suddenly he has an encounter with heaven, an open heaven. He has an encounter with a realm that he never was able to perceive within the framework of religion. And that resulted in power in his life. And everyone that then he met who had the same encounter with the living God also had power in their life. The power of divine glory. It's not an offense to people because they think they found in the scripture where you're not supposed to do it. It's an offense to them because they don't have it. Healing and miracles is not an offense to people because the blind saw and the deaf heard. It is an offense to them because it reveals their lack a relationship with the living God. And they had built themselves up in their religious ideology that they were head and shoulders above everybody else. Thus they could not hear the choir sing. Thus they could not perceive the star. The tokens of God was meaningless. It had no value to them. It did not draw. The Lord says this. He says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. He has put his thoughts in me, and in my life he has established his ways. Isn't that good? Yeah. It's true. But there has to be a response. My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. And you can hear 1 Corinthians chapter 2 screaming out, where God's saying, eyes not see, ears not heard, heavens have not been opened to you, neither is it any man understood it in their heart, but God has come to make them known by His Spirit. Now the natural mind cannot receive the things which are of God, because it's foreign to him. It's alien to him. Huh? Can you hear it? You can hear the ringing out of the encounters. Jesus says, come, from this day forward, you'll see heaven and you'll see angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. You'll see all heaven open. You'll see more than Jacob saw there on Bethel. I am Bethel. I am heaven manifested in all the fullness of the glory. I am the revelation of the Father. I am the door that you can enter in and find the wonderful realms of this eternal life, this God kind of life. Joshua saw far less than that. Joshua heard far less than that, and he didn't depart from the door of the tabernacle, standing there beholding the glory. There's an encounter to have. There's an encounter to have. There's an encounter to have. He's not a little baby lying in a manger no more. He is the King of glory, sitting upon the throne of judgment. He's the baptizer in the Holy Ghost. Fundamental to relationship and intimacy with him is knowing him as the baptizer of the Holy Ghost, because that's his heavenly ministry. 10 years later, Peter is talking about what John said. He baptized in the Holy Ghost. And it happens. Acts 10. 20 years later, Paul is still talking about what John said. He baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And it's still happening. John the Baptist revealed him and proclaimed who he was. It stretches all the way out to Paul and to this day to me. If I'm going to preach the gospel that they preached, I'm going to declare what Jesus is doing. There's an encounter. There's no greater encounter of power and authority than what Father wants to do when he calls us, this wonderful ministry of his Son, to become realized by us and become effective in our life. He says to us, for as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and returns not there, but waters the earth and makes it bring forth the bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish what I said, what I declared. It will prosper in those things whereunto I've sent it. These works and greater works, if you've received what I've said, if you've responded to this interaction that I made available for you to have with me, you're going to be led forth in joy. You'll go out in peace. This reality of all that I've said concerning my thoughts and my ways and all that I've described by my word that I've declared that you shall have, that the power and authority shall come upon you, that the outpouring of the Spirit shall be yours, that you shall prophesy, that you shall move in signs and wonders and miracles and gifts and demonstration of the power and the glory. If you've got a relationship with me, if you've allowed my word to come into your life, it will accomplish it. If there's a relationship with me, what I described will be in your life. That's where we step back and go, hold up. I'm not looking to self-justify myself. I'm not looking to justify myself, have self-righteousness, make myself right in my own eyes. I want to be tested, assayed by the word. If I don't have what God says and described should be in my life in terms of the life and the glory and the nature and the power and the interaction with the living God, then I'm ready to change. I'm ready to repent. I'm ready to cooperate. I'm willing. I'm ready. I'm ready to make whatever adjustments need to be made. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm not willing to continue on doing the same thing. If you cut the board and it was short, if you measure it in the same way, it will be short the next time too. And after that, and after that, and after that. At some point you're going to have to say, I'm cutting this board too short because I'm doing it wrong. I am going to now learn how to do it right. So that when I make this cut, the board will be the right length. I'm willing to change my daily activities, the way that I function, the way that I interact with people, the way that I interact with God. I'm willing to allow my dispositions to be adjusted and altered and perfected by Him. I'm willing to learn how to walk in humility and brokenness. I'm willing to be like a shepherd tending the flock rather than the scholar of scholar and the Pharisee of Pharisee standing in the temple. Where is it that you want to be? I doubt Anna knew as much as anybody as all the rest of the people around her. But she simply had something she was waiting on. I doubt that Zechariah had the prestige of all the rest of the older guys that were around him in the community of the Pharisees. But he had a word that produced within him. He had an encounter produced with him in desperation. All he did was wait, knowing that his eyes would see God's salvation. Have you had any word from heaven about what God wants to do in your life that has caused you to set everything down and allow everything of your life to be adjusted to say, I am now waiting. I am now calling. I'm now making whatever adjustments. I'm making whatever changes necessary so that I can be able to move in this opportunity that God has made available to me. This is faith. This is the reality of relationship. This is where religion and relationship are parsed out. I want you to stand with me. Somebody asked me, well, do you believe that Jesus was born on December 25th? No. Well, don't you know it's a Babylonian cult day? It was to them, but it ain't to me. So he wasn't born on December 20th, but yeah, I know he was. Well, then please tell me what day he was born on. Well, I don't know. Well, then shut up. Has nothing to do with that. Well, somebody somewhere, sometime in the past, hooked it up with an ancient, pagan holiday. Big deal. It ain't pagan no more. It got sanctified. It's like pig. You can eat it now. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's like shrimp and lobster. Go ahead and have some. Hallelujah. He sanctified it. God's not confused. He's not going, oh no. They're worshiping my son on the wrong day. They're acknowledging that he was born on the wrong day. People run around fighting. A whole world stops on December 25th. The whole world stops. I tell you, every nation, even North Korea, the Sudan, Kashmir, the whole world stops and acknowledges a day. They have different actions, different reactions, different opinions. But in unreached people groups, it's the greatest day of evangelism because you go out and nobody's going to stop you from giving out gifts and saying, this is what Jesus did. This is what God did. He did it through his only begotten son, Jesus. You can even do it in Jerusalem. You can do it in the east part of, on the east bank in Jerusalem. Hallelujah. People caught up in strife, division, every damnable heresy that the devil can produce to just run amok. To run interference with what God is doing. It happens in so many dimensions of our life because we're puffed up with knowledge. It's time to get some power. When you have an encounter with Jesus, suddenly you will go from trying to attain righteousness, as Paul once did, to having received the righteousness of God. That was the encounter. That's what the encounter did. There's people all in Christianity, all over the place, trying to attain righteousness and their identity as sinner because they've not had an encounter with Jesus who makes them a saint, who takes away their sin and gives them the gift of righteousness even though they don't deserve it. Somebody who's waiting to get good enough to get right with God, you will find yourself eternally lost because you will never be good enough to be right with God. God makes you right in His mercy and His grace. So that you can say, He's all my righteousness. I stand complete in Him and worship Him. Today I pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that you'll begin to hear the angels sing and you'll sing with them. And that will take you from another entire dimension where you begin to sing a song that they must be silent over. Suddenly they begin to listen to you and they say, oh, the angels, oh, that I might hear the saints sing. Oh, that I might be around when the holy people of God who've been bought with the blood of the living God and filled with the very spirit that God Himself has, worship. Tables get turned. It's time, people. It's time. It's high time. Seek the Lord. While He may be found, call upon Him while He's near. Because if you'll respond to the call, just a simple call, come and see. Come and see. Nathaniel could have said, then you know what, Philip, there you are. You're always off on this thing, man. Anybody comes along, says Messiah, says moving of the Spirit of God, you over there, you're just going from one thing to the next. Get out of here. Leave me alone. Because that's the kind of people Jesus surrounded Himself with. Peter was not the chief of the Pharisees. John was not the scholar of scholars. James was not the one who understood the dark, hidden secrets. The great prophet of the land. They were fishermen. They were simple fishermen. Who, if you asked them a Bible question, they would just say, I don't know. I don't know. Grandpa said something like this. Dad had a little different opinion. But all we were doing catching fish today. We're just working hard catching fish. We got to catch fish every day. We poor people. We just got to catch fish. Otherwise, family can't eat. We go to synagogue on the Sabbath and we hear the scripture read. But I don't know. It's to those people that the Almighty God can come and say, behold, I'm what all Israel's been waiting for. And them not scoff and go, well, you don't line up with all of my opinions. Because they don't have any opinions. You hear what I'm saying? Yeah. You hear what I'm saying? Yeah. If he went to the Pharisee, and they'll do it even today. You don't line up with my opinions. It would have been no value. Does Jesus line up with your opinions? Does the moving of the Holy Ghost line up with your opinions? Oh, well, false prophets.
You're the biggest false prophet you've ever known. You speak more of things that are contrary to the word of God to yourself than any single person on the planet could ever possibly get across to you. All the nonsense. People, you know what that is? Spirit of fear. I'm not worried about no false prophet. I hear the voice of the shepherd. I'm his sheep. A voice of another I will not hear. I'm not worried about lying spirits. The Holy Ghost has come to lead me, guide me into all truth. I'm not worried about the lie. All that fearful and unbelieving nonsense about why people suddenly want to go ahead and entrench themselves, enclose themselves with their ideology, their philosophy. Can't work when love is all that exists. Because Father's bigger than all these other things, and he sees truth, and he sees the state of the heart, and he comes with an encounter of revelation. He comes with an encounter of the spirit of wisdom and insight. He comes with the encounter. Oh my God. I break off the lies and the fear and the torment and all the concepts of men relying upon themselves to know God in the name of Jesus Christ, so that you can submit yourself to the righteousness of God, the living God, be drawn by Him, be captivated by Him, be called by Him, separated by Him, taught of God. I am taught not of men, but I am taught of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of... Listen today, if you're standing in this place and you're not certain that you have the righteousness of God, if you're not certain that you're holy even as He is holy. Because that's God's command. Be holy even as I'm holy. God's command, you know that everyone who does righteousness is righteous even as He's righteous. And if you're not certain, if you're not pure even as He's pure, if you're not living even as He lives, walking even as He walks, today God wants to give that gift to you. He wants to give it to you. And it is experiential, it's positional, it's imparted, it's imputed, it's relational, and it's ethical. And if you understand the argument, I ended it. Did you understand? You know what I mean? If you understand the theological argument, I just ended it. If you don't, good for you. And I hope you never do. I hope you just embrace what He's given. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? This is Christmas. Every day is Christmas, but this is special. And today, you've been willing to come in here and intercede along with me and break off the yoke of a religious activity of the church and of nations by saying, we're going to worship the one who is incarnated, the one who was born in the city of David, in Bethlehem. We're going to worship God Almighty, the one who's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the one who was and is to come, the Almighty. Oh, hallelujah. God wants to make you right. You can't make yourself right. If you let God make you right, you will be right. You will learn to be right. If you'll let God make you holy, you'll be holy and learn how to be holy. And if you won't do that, and if you've got to work it out, then you're trying to climb up some other way, and you're a thief and a liar and a robber. But if you let Jesus be the way, if you let Jesus be the truth, if you let Jesus be the life, if you let Him be the solution, if you let Him be your problem solver, your fixer, so that you become a God-made man, shaped by Him, taught of God, come now. If through your own discipline and your own efforts you attain unto what you call as righteousness, I tell you it's self-righteousness.
And it's going about seeking to establish your own righteousness and not submitting yourself to the righteousness of God. You fit right into Romans chapter 11, exactly what Paul was saying. When all of a sudden you recognize that he's made you a new creation and he's empowered you to live the life he's living, and it's all by that work of grace which he has given, suddenly you can begin to be what he created us to be because you agree with God. I'm going to wait a few minutes. There's no way that you can worship God on a higher dimension than receiving the gift he's given. There's no gift that he wants from you and me but to receive the gift he's given. I have no gift to give him but a surrendered heart and yielded life. What will you do today? I pray that you will receive what God has given. I pray that your eyes will be open, that you'll be able to see that God found no intercessor, so he himself became the intercessor to perfect us, to establish us unreprovable, unrebukable, unblameable in his presence. What will you do? What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with the gift that God has given? If you'll find yourself receiving freely what he's given, I promise you, you will freely give it. And I promise you, you will fully live it. You will fully live it. Just to make sure that everybody understands me, there is no possibility that 10 billion years from now, you can be more righteous than the moment you called upon the name of Jesus in your sin and iniquity and ungodliness. The moment you called upon the name of Jesus in your sin and iniquity and ungodliness, you became the righteousness of God, the very righteousness of Christ Jesus, and you can never be more righteous, not 10 billion years from now. And this is what parses out and differentiates those who are in the faith and those who are in religion, those who depend upon a relationship with Jesus, and those who walk after their own human effort and ability. This is truly the difference between what God has given to us by his grace and legalism. I come and worship him because of his precious blood. I come with all boldness in the holies of holies, not because of any works of righteousness which I've done, not because I've done everything right or done some things wrong. I come and worship him by the blood. I come with the blood of Jesus. When you can rely upon what you believe that you've done, you've not had an encounter with God and seen the one who's holy, holy, holy. Like the prophet Isaiah, who was a great prophet, but he has an encounter with God. And he says, he puts his hands over his mouth. And he goes, I'm unclean. The righteous and perfect man, Job, has an encounter with God. He says, I abhor myself. After the encounter, before he would not condemn himself, but now he's had an encounter. Your perception is wrong. You've not seen how holy he is. You've not seen how righteous he is. To see how holy he is and then hear him say, be holy even as I am holy, you recognize right then and there a gift has been imparted. To encounter him and see how righteous he is and then hear him say, be righteous even as I am righteous, you then understand, wait a minute, something big has happened for me and on my behalf. Come on, people. It's time to worship the living God. It's time to get out of your faucet. Because when you step into this realm, when you step into this new creation, when you step into this life, suddenly you are finding yourself conformed to the image. You find yourself with the power and the authority and the ability to be what he has given us the gift to be. As long as you're trying to produce it for yourself, you can never have it. You'll never have it. Never. Worship the King. See Jesus. You want to see heaven? You want to see heaven open? You want to see heaven open? You want to see angels ascending and descending? You want to see all the glory of God? Look at Jesus. See Jesus. See Jesus. 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 Somebody says, I want to see open heaven. See Jesus. I want to want to have an encounter with God. Just a few more minutes. Just a few more minutes. I want you to be able to walk out of here today and say, I'm holy even as He is holy.
Yes.
If you're going to put that off, then you may die in your sin. Die rather in your unbelief. I'll just put it that way. Because God said, be holy even as I am holy. And if you think for a moment that by some self-effort you can be that, you are deceived. You are lied to. You've never encountered the holiness of God. You have a wrong fashion and opinion of what that means. It's a gift to receive today. It's a gift of life. It's the gift of His life. It's the gift of eternal life. It's the gift of God. It's the gift of Christ Jesus. It's an invitation to come and live and exist and dwell in Him. I live and exist and dwell in Him. I do not come to God based upon my own person. For God rejects and accepts not the person of any man. I find myself completely in this life that Jesus gave for me. This is what He was born for. This is why we worship today in this special way. Come on, listen to me. Come on, listen to me. I'm going to just stand here and worship. I'm going to bow down before Him. I'm going to say, You are my righteousness. You forever, Lord, shall be called the Lord, my righteousness. And because You set me apart and You sanctified me, my great high priest, upon the special shall be written, holiness unto the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Holiness unto the Lord. Holiness unto the Lord. If that's not what you have, if that's not what you believe, God's asking you to believe the good news. Peace on earth. Peace on earth means that God says, I reach out to you to have a relationship with you. Peace on earth. Goodwill. God's goodwill.
Yes.
Towards all men.
God's
goodwill to you. Peace to you. Draw near, He says. Come nigh. Come now, He says. Come with your heart. Come now. If there's a separation between you and God, it is a demonic power that has put it there. For the blood removed it. Today it's time for you to have faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, which removes all separation between God and man. There's a distance between you and Him. If you lack His approval, it's because you've been lied to and you've rejected the approval that God has given of His own Son and the invitation that He's made for everyone come dwell in Him. You want to see heaven open? John said, I saw heaven open. Matthew 3:16, I saw heaven open. The Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Ghost, descended upon Him, gentle like a dove. You want to see heaven open? Jesus. He's the open heaven. He's a means for us by which we can see the angel of the Lord and the chariot thereof. It's the means by which we can see we dwell in the house of God at noon and night. It's the means by which we can begin to cooperate with all the supernatural signs and wonders. The Father Himself is now doing the exploits of His power that is far above all principality and power, might, dominion over all sin and sickness and disease, every torment of the enemy, every lying, oppressive thing that will afflict and torment people. If you do not pursue this for your own life and demand this for your own life, and to pursue this and demand this for the life of your people, your children, your family. Demand it for the household of God. You're not participating in His righteous cause. If you're willing to just let back, set back and just let it go, just let it be. You've not joined league in His army. You fell by the wayside. You were overcome instead of being an overcomer. We're going to watch over God's heritage, and we're going to place God's demand upon them, and we're going to demand they repent. We will command men everywhere to repent. Hallelujah. Beginning with ourselves and our family. Hallelujah. And the church. Praise God. Let up one bit. You can ignore us. You can go with your own conscience. do whatever you think you seems right in your own eyes. But we're not going to stop. We're going to command you to get right with God, listen and obey. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on now. In His stead. And you know what we're going to command you to do? Be justified. We're going to command you to be changed. We're going to command you to be acceptable to God. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Merry Christmas. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I tell you, there's no present like His presence. There's no gift like His manifest glory. And I pray the day that you, as you walk around December 25th, the day that we've consecrated to acknowledge the coming of Almighty God in human flesh, that it will be filled with His manifest presence in an extraordinary way. Because I'm telling you right now, God is a God who constantly keeps a celebration going. He constantly consecrates a day to remember. God is a remembering God. And if you want to try to tell me that Father's not involved in this worldwide remembrance of that great thing that He did when He gave us the gift of His only begotten Son, I will tell you that you are confused. You're confused. For Father doesn't matter if to Him, if we celebrate and consecrate this day on December 25th or on July the 4th. It makes no difference to Him. No day is any different from any other. And if you'll begin to celebrate it now, then perhaps you'll celebrate Christmas every day. If you'll begin to celebrate Sabbath now, then you'll celebrate Sabbath every day. Hallelujah. If you begin to celebrate Pentecost now, you celebrate it every day. That's one of the things I love about keeping Passover. You used to keep Passover, celebrate Passover on Passover day. You celebrate every day. Same way with Pentecost. Same way Feast of Tabernacles. Hallelujah. Same way with Christmas. Same way with Thanksgiving. And we do not do Halloween. Ever. Amen. Praise God. Praise the name of Jesus. Well, people, we'll be back here tonight at 6 o'clock. We're gonna lay hold on moving in the gifts of the Spirit. Let me just tell you something. God has called you to seek first the kingdom. And there is no description of you seeking the kingdom as your participation in church. Whatever you do with the church and in the church is what you are actually doing in the kingdom, because it's no contest. The church is the vehicle of the kingdom of God. It is it. It is the body of Christ. It's the pillar and the foundation of the truth. And what you do with the church, you're doing in the kingdom. And what you give to the church, you're giving in the kingdom. And that's the way God set it up. And so you understand it. You've got a measure. You've got a report card every day right there. It's how much you're participating. We've got it's not earning anything. It's just, it's seeking. It's wanting. It's desiring. It's not you out of obligation. Because it's relationship, not legalization. Not some legal thing. So I just want to encourage you. Listen, tonight we're going to press it, and then we're going to have Wednesday night service, and then we're going to have a New Year's service, New Year's Eve service. And I know some of you are consecrating with us a fast going into the new year. Some of you can do 21 days. Some of you, maybe you don't know how to fast like that. Maybe you can do, you know, 30 minutes. Maybe you can do a day. Maybe you can make it a day. But it can't be about you going without food. You hear me? Some people fast, and all they can think of is, I'm going without food. How much longer is left for me to have to go without food? No, it's just like, it's just setting yourself aside to seek the Lord. Say, Lord, I want to lay hold on these things. I'm hungry. I'm hungry for a different kind of food. I'm hungry for the food that only you can supply. And if you read from Genesis all the way through Revelation, you discover that that has an impact on God, even if you're Nineveh. the most wicked icon city in the Bible. Outside of Babylon, Nineveh is it. Nineveh and Babylon, really, in many ways, they're synonyms. And even that Nineveh, when they fasted and cried out to God, look at what the Lord did. His divine intervention. I want a divine intervention. And I pray that you want one too. I pray that I want a divine encounter. I've had one or two or three or four or five or many. I've had multitudes of divine encounters. But I want more than I've ever had before. I'm more hungry than I've ever been. I know less than I ever have. And I love more than I've ever loved. And I pray that you come get in this. It's good. It's good. Come on now. Come get in this. It's good. Amen. Worship the Lord with your giving. Worship Him. Somebody said, well, I just bought a bunch of Christmas presents. Worship the Lord with your giving. Just worship Him. Honor the Lord with your substance and with all the first fruits of your increase. And He's going to work a miracle for you. It is the only thing that God says in the Word, His Word, that you could prove Him by. Let me say it again. It is the only thing that God says in His Word that you can prove Him by. Let me say this to you. If you find a dollar on the side of a road, 10 cents of it already belongs to God. If you keep that 10 cents, then you're holding on to something that is not yours. If somebody gives you $10,000, $1,000 of that already belonged to God. It was already christened and dedicated, consecrated to God before it was given to you. And if you keep that, you're holding on to something that doesn't belong to you. If $1,000,000 falls out of heaven and lands in your lap, $100,000 of that already belonged to God. It's His. And if you keep it, you're holding on to something that doesn't belong to you, and God will require it of you. If you work dog-tired hard and you make $100, I don't care, $10 of that belonged to God. He's the one who gave you the ability to work so hard in the first place. If you killed yourself working all your life and made $10,000, $1,000 of it belongs to God. And it is an honorable thing not to steal from Him. And it's the only thing God said by which we could prove Him. He says, prove now, prove me now with your tithes and with your offerings. Somebody said, well, that's under legalism. Yeah, it is, but it is also under promise and relationship too. Because Abraham did it, and he wasn't under the law and wasn't under legalism. And Jacob did it, and he wasn't under the law or legalism. And I do it, and I'm not under the law or legalism. I don't do it out of because of necessity, or rather under obligation. I do it under relationship, just like Abraham did it. See, Abraham didn't do it under obligation. Huh? The Pharisees did it under obligation. Daniel did it under obligation. Because of that time period that they're in. But we do it out of relationship. And what happens to the value of it and the meaning of it and the responsibility in it? Much higher. Much higher. Amen. So just come worship the Lord if you haven't already. If you have, find a bunch of people around you. And there are a bunch of people around you. The faithful few are here. Hug them. Bless them. Tell them that you love them. And don't stop doing that. Continue to do that. Hallelujah.